I find myself in times of trouble. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. In my hour of darkness, she's standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. When the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. Though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they may see. There will be an answer, let it be. Sing with me. Let it be, let it be.
Dave again. Yet again, we're putting out a service this week when I had thought that we wouldn't be. If I'm really honest, this being Mothering Sunday and it being such a minefield for people who have not had good experiences of motherhood for all kinds of reasons, I'd seriously thought about ducking it altogether and not putting a service out this week. And indeed, that was what I was going to do. Then, out of the blue, unsolicited from us, our good friend Henry Martin sent us a sermon. And it's such a sensitive sermon, such a graceful sermon, that doesn't shy away from all our experiences of motherhood, good and bad, and addresses them all, as I say, with grace. And I'm deeply indebted to him. And I hope that his words will bless you. They've blessed me, as I've been putting this together and listening to it a couple of times. They really have blessed me. And I'm grateful for that. So I hope that you enjoy the service. I hope you thank Henry for doing it. I'm going to get out of the way now. And it's over to you. Bless you.
Mm-hmm. faithfully followed your star, and it has brought us to this place. But we are unsure of what is to come. Here, in the depths of winter, we shelter with you, safe from the ice and the snow, not sure of where following you will take us, but trusting you to guide us through this winter, to keep us safe from all that the world can hurl at us. Fill us with all the hope and anticipation here at the beginning of Lent as we enter into this desert experience. Hear our cry, Lord. Come to us, reside in us, rescue us, love us. Keep us safe through these dark days. Grant us that hope, grant us your peace, grant us your joy, grant us your light. We gather here online as those who have hungered and thirst for your justice and peace, as those who have strived to be treated as equal, as those who have longed to be included, as those who have longed to feel love, as those who have yearned for our abuse to have been recognised, accepted and healed. We have prayed, we have hoped, we have waited, we have dared to dream, but we are tired, Lord. It's hard to stay optimistic, to keep bitterness at bay, and not to be overwhelmed by your anger. It is hard to simply carry on. We huddle together across the web, looking for your outstretched hand, for your light during these dark days. We need to feel the warmth and light of your love. We beg you, Lord, to draw near and to grant us your peace. There is power in the union we have found together, this pilgrim band of outsiders, misfits and dreamers. The brave people who join us in the struggle for equality and equity and inclusion, this diverse band of differing races, genders, sexualities and abilities. Keep us safe, Lord, in this space as we head into such an uncertain time. We are all made in many different ways. A diverse collection of your children drawing alongside one another, to share fellowship with each other and to worship you, Lord. Reassure us that all are welcome here, all are accepted here, all are allied with here, all very different, yet all united. We rejoice at the opportunity to celebrate the many ways we reflect different aspects of you, our God, and we embrace the message of inclusion woven throughout your gospel. And we pray, Lord, we pray that that vision becomes clearer and is embraced by your whole church. Amen.
Welcome. Welcome the tired, the exhausted, the worn out, the grieving. Welcome the scared ones, the frightened and nervous ones, the ones whose trust has been betrayed, the ones who have not known what it feels like to feel safe, the lost and the sad ones, the penniless poor ones, the outcast and shunned ones, the I don't fit in ones, the shut out and locked out ones, unable to scale the wall, the ones that churches forgot, the ones the churches would rather not look at, the ones church has abused and mistreated and are now too ashamed to look at. Welcome again to this sacred place, this holy ground, as real to us as any church building. Our home is here, on YouTube, on Twitter, and on our website. Online is where we live and have our being. These are places of welcome, open to all, and we do mean all. Though we are in many ways estranged from your church, we thank you, Lord, for those on the inside who support us, who join with us each week and who continue to intercede for us and carry our cause forward within the church, week in, week out. The ones who recognize our need and who bravely support us. Stay for as little or as long as you like. be as involved or not as you feel comfortable being. Many of us that gather here are unable to access physical church even before the pandemic, and here we have been made welcome and have found a home. This is our space. Come on in and join us. We dedicate this space to those who have been excluded for loving someone in a way that has been judged wrongly, to those whose personhood has been challenged wrongly, to those who have been made to feel unworthy because of the colour of their skin or the nature of their disability. Father, take this place and those gathered here and make this a place of hope, a place of encouragement, a place of refuge, and a place of peace. Amen. To those who are just too tired, we say, welcome. To those in need of rest, we say, welcome. To those who feel they have reached the end of their rope, we say, welcome. To those who are new here, we say, welcome. To those who are familiar faces, we say, welcome. To those who are confident of their place here, we say, welcome. To those who are unsure if we will really include everyone, we say, welcome. To those who have been hurt by bad theology and harmful pastoral practices, we say, welcome. To those who never thought they would find an inclusive faith environment, we say, welcome. To those who join us at a later date and time, you are welcome. And above all, Jesus, we welcome you into our presence. This is your temple, Lord. Although there are no walls, the web is where we gather, as real to us as any church. Computers, phones and tablets are our prayer books. Our prayers float in the ether like incense across the sanctuary. Fellowship comes in many forms, and ours is here, online.
Let us take a few moments to consider the times when we have not acted as we would have liked this week, for the times we have not understood the needs of others or ourselves, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have paid no attention to what is happening to our neighbours, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have forgotten your promises to us, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have not been able to share or receive, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have not recognized or challenged our inherent prejudices, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have not kept scrolling and kept out of the argument, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have not invited you into the center of our lives, we say, God, forgive us. For the times we have simply followed the herd and not asked what you would have us do, we say, God, forgive us. In asking your forgiveness, gracious God, help us to be transformed, that we might live as people of your kingdom, following your way and trusting your wise counsel. Open our hearts, Lord, to the warmth of your love. Amen.
So we've come to Mothering Sunday, which is a wonderful day, but not without its challenges. For many, this is a wondrous and joyous day, a day to pamper and be pampered. But we also need to recognise that for some, Mothering Sunday is difficult, and for a few, it's the most dreaded day of the year. I'm thinking of those who very much wanted to have children, but sadly have not been able. For those who are struggling to become mothers, for those who have difficult relationships with their mothers, or perhaps mothers who have difficult relationships with their children, for those for whom grief is prominent today. Grief for a mother or grief for a child. For all such people, Mothering Sunday can be painful. No one wants to spoil a party, but for some, they're just not able to join in today. Today's also a challenge for preachers, because none of the Gospels contain even one truly suitable story for today. I've often thought it would be so great if the Gospels relayed just one sweet story about Jesus as an adult having a normal day and getting on well with his mum. Perhaps it could relate an incident when Jesus decided to put all his appointments on one side and devote some quality time to visiting his mother. We could read a little story about how he took her a special gift and then made a memorable put down to whichever disciple questioned him about the use of his time. Imagine Norman Rockwell's painting, Freedom from Want. But instead of a happy, white, all-American family, we could see Jesus with his siblings, united in joyful anticipation, while Mary presides at the table, groaning under the weight of food. No, better still, Mary would be seated at the table and somebody else would be doing the serving because they'd done all the cooking as well because it was Mary's day off and it was her day to be treated. Sadly, no such story has been recorded in the Gospels, which is a shame because, in all likelihood, Jesus did make time for his mother. He was clearly close to her and he remained so throughout his earthly life, even to the point where, from the cross, he directs John to look after her. There are a few stories about Jesus and his mother, but none of them are particularly happy. Jesus often comes across as less than pleased to see her. Or, as in Alan Bennett's play, Chip and the Sugar, his character Graham says, "Well, I've always thought Jesus was a bit offhand with his mother, and on one occasion, he was downright snotty with her." So a better reading for today comes from John's Gospel, where Jesus says to Nicodemus, that God so loved the world that God gave his only Son. And I like the inclusivity of the word world because it means all of us, including those that the church has a sad record of excluding. God so loved the world, not just some of us, but all of us. Despite this, certain wings of the church have tried to recruit Jesus as the poster boy for traditional family values. But this is the same Jesus who, in full hearing of his mum and before a large crowd, asked, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" And then he points to his disciples and says, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." That comment alone surely disqualifies him from any post as advocate of traditional family values by the standards of his day and ours. It also makes anyone who does the will of God in heaven his mother and brother and sister, which puts a very different spin on Mothering Sunday. Nevertheless, those who oppose inclusion seem happy to hide behind a manufactured, unbiblical, family-friendly version of Jesus, making out that some of the people they exclude are a threat not only to them, but to traditional marriage and to susceptible children, and to Jesus as well, and his whole plan for ideal suburban living. Families are always going to be messier than a suburban home, mum, dad and 2.4 children. And being a mother, to return to today's theme, is consequently always going to be a messy business. Mary had ample warning of this. Not that that made it any easier when the time came, but even when Jesus was a tiny baby, she knew this because an elderly man told her that being his mum would mean that one day a sword would pierce her soul. Surely there were some sweet times for Jesus and his mum. But as I've said before, the Gospel writers tend to record the sour ones. And clearly, for Jesus, family does not always come first. Family is important to him, but it is never the bottom line. Some people need to step back from their families because the family atmosphere is one in which they cannot be their true selves. Tragically for some, family can be a crucible of abuse. I don't know if you've ever read the Armistead Maupin novels, the Tales of the City series, and he talks about how many LGBTQ+ people are distanced from their biological families and so create logical families. He has these great characters, Michael Tolliver, Marianne Singleton, and so on, and they all rotate round a wonderful mother figure of Anna Madrigal. And over the course of 9 books, she stands consistently as their logical mother. Church, at its best, is family. Church, online or in presence, in buildings or on screens, is both a spiritual family and a logical family. When we do church well, we find many mothers within the family of church, mothers who will nurture us, and many to whom we can show mothering love, regardless of our genders or our statuses as married, single, parent, or child-free. Because church done well, whether in person or online, is where we live and love together to the rhythm of God's heartbeat, and God is beyond gender. But if God is to be called Heavenly Father, she is certainly also our Heavenly Mother. God generously watches over us with wonderful mothering love. God so loved the world that she gave herself, her Son Jesus, so that all who believe in Jesus should not perish, but share God's eternal life. Amen.
Jesus, as we reflect on what it is to be equals, to feel included, help us to create a space where people feel able to put down their pack and sit for a while, a place where they can enjoy every sandwich. For a service we are able to attend easily, we thank you. For people who understand, we thank you. For a place that even the darkness cannot penetrate, we thank you. For those who have the courage to stand up for the marginalised, no matter what the cost, we thank you. God of light, a light that breaks through the darkness, a light that penetrates all hidden corners, a light that came to us through a little child born in Bethlehem, we have followed your star, and it has brought us here to this sacred place, alone and yet together. May we continue to search diligently for him each day, so that we may offer our lives to you in joy and thanksgiving. Teach us a new song, Lord, a song for those who go unsung. Praise the ones that do our dirty work, the pushers of chairs, the wipers of bums, the makers of tea, the givers of meds. Teach us that new song, Lord, that lets them know they are loved. The ones who put their own dreams on hold, Lord, that give until they are spent, and then get up again tomorrow and do it all again. The ones that go unnoticed, Lord, quietly meeting our needs, yet keep us rolling along. Teach us to say thank you, Lord, for every ounce of care. Teach us to say thank you to the ones who, although isolated and alone, dedicate their time to interceding for others, the ones who we don't know yet, whose prayer sustains us. Teach us more each day about how to truly include everyone, to mean it when we say it, and to reflect it in both our online and written presence. God, now let us bring before you those we know of in need of you at this time. In a moment of silence, we hold them before you and ask your blessing on their lives. Those who cannot see, he walks with as guide. He whispers softly to those who cannot hear. He soothes those whose minds are troubled. He rides with those who cannot walk. He sees the pain of those whose pain cannot be seen, and brings insight to those who appear not to understand. God of hope, bring us love that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought peace into this world, be the peace that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought joy into the world, be the joy that dwells between us.
May you stand in joy before God's face, and may his grace embrace your being. May Christ guide you to his light. May his love conquer your darkness. May the life-creating spirit bless each bone of your flesh, each pore of your being. Beloved ones, beloved ones. May God's goodness be yours, and well may it befall you. May God's goodness be yours, and well and seven times well may you spend your lives. The love of your Creator be with you. The love of your Judge be with you. The love of your Saviour be with you. May Mary and Bridget and Michael shield you on sea, shield you on land, each step, each path you travel. The love of the One, the love of the Three be with you.
Thank you. something moving out of you, your body and your skin. Like mist comes from the water. You can sense it when the cold has clenched its claws. And alone you face what's coming. Against a bed of green.